Welcome to the Million Pound Mission Podcast. I'm your host, Adam Shibley, the PhD, the previously heavy dude, and I'm on a 1 million pound mission. Now, I've personally lost over 100 pounds, and I've applied what I've learned from my own transformation journey to help my hometown clients lose over 35,000 pounds in just 5 years. Now I'm on a mission to produce over 1 million pounds of results by delivering my best weekly tips, motivation, inspirational stories, and transformation strategies so that you can gain clarity about what you need to do to reach your goals and give you the confidence to take action. And the perfect time to start taking action is right now. So let's do this. Hey everybody, before we dive into this episode, I want to welcome on a brand new sponsorship partner, Ultra Human. Now, as always, I was a client of these guys first. I chased them down. I said, I love your stuff. I'd love to get you involved as a sponsor. So they agreed, and here we are. Now, these products are amazing. They have three products, and they are the best of the best. One is a nootropic called Tao, T-A-O. Some pronounce it Tao, but I'm from Indiana, so I pronounce it Tao. You're just lucky I don't pronounce it Tao. And it's an amazing nootropic. I've been trying it either late morning or even midday as a little cognitive boost, and you feel the difference. You don't feel jittery, but you feel very focused and dialed in. I love it. They also have a Keto Plus MCT product. Completely changed my opinion about exogenous ketones. You guys have to check this out if you want to avoid keto flu and have a little bit better workouts while you're on the ketogenic diet. And they have a product called Amino Code. It's the best. It is the absolute best amino acid product I have ever used. It is amazing. My recovery is off the charts. And I love this stuff. So hopefully you can tell that I am all in on Ultra Human. I want you to check them out at theultrahuman.net. That's theultrahuman.net. Hit up the promo code MPM20. Get 20% off as a Million Pound Mission podcast listener. Now, after this episode, I want you to listen in as I'm going to give you the details on my brand new Million Pound Mission Bootcamp and how you can get involved. If you can't wait that long, just go to millionpoundmission.com. Make sure you get on the wait list so you get first dibs on those roster spots for the Million Pound Mission Bootcamp launching in July. Hello, my friends, and welcome to another episode of the Million Pound Mission Podcast. It's your buddy Adam, the PhD, the previously heavy dude. And this is episode number 144, Living Life in the Ready State with Kelly and Juliet Starrett. I am psyched about this one. I've been looking forward to this interview for so long. Kelly and Juliet are two people that I really have a lot of respect for. I look up to them in the health and fitness space. And I think this interview, it was just so much fun. And they dropped so much knowledge. And you guys are going to love it. Now, Kelly, if you don't know who these two superstars are, the power couple, Kelly, he's a coach, he's a physical therapist, he's an author, he's a speaker, and he's the creator of the website mobilitywad.com, which has revolutionized how athletes think about human movement and athletic performance. I found his stuff a few years ago. We kind of dive into that in the episode, so you have to listen in to hear that story. Now, Juliet, his wife, is an attorney. She's an entrepreneur. She's the co-founder and CEO of San Francisco CrossFit, which was one of the first 50 CrossFit affiliates in the world, which is awesome. And she's also the co-creator and founder of mobilitywad.com, which I mentioned a second ago. Now, I love the vibe these two bring to the interview because Kelly is like super high energy and he's just dropping jokes and he's hilarious. And Juliet just brings this sincere and calming vibe to the equation and it works out really well. In this interview, Team Starrett and I discuss things like how they define the ready state and how we can work on getting there ourselves. They talk about the things that the average American is doing to mess up our bodies. And then we discuss how we can actually start to correct some of this damage and start feeling and moving better. And then they give some simple action steps and processes that they focus on to improve their own health and the health of their children. You're going to love this episode. So without further delay, my friends, here it is. Episode number 144, Living Life in the Ready State with Kelly and Juliet Starrett. All right, Kelly, Juliet, welcome to the Million Pound Mission Podcast. How are you doing today, my friends?
Woo, woo, we're great. Stoked to be here.
All right. So I want to jump right into things. And I have to tell you, the first time I was exposed to the Mobility Wad, all the material you have online, I'm just kind of doing the basic internet search. I'm like, mobility, I need to work on things like this. And I find your video. I'm like, this guy seems interesting. First stretch, first mobility exercise I do, couch stretch. All right. So, and I'm on there, like I'm getting wedged into the couch. I'm, you know, sitting up, squeezing my glute, thrusting my hip forward. And then Kelly says something along the lines of, it's going to feel like a rabid honey badger is in your hip flexor gnawing at yours. There was something along those lines. I'm like, I can get down with this guy. You know, this guy, it's not your average, like, stretching yoga thing. So, Juliet, the first question is for you. Do you have any favorite, like, Kellyism? Like, he's got a lot of, you know, patented Kelly Starrett lines that I've grown to know.
Let me take this.
Yeah, all right.
So what is that? What does it look like? What's the top one or two?
Geez, I mean, I don't know if I could pinpoint an actual Kellyism. Like, right when you said that, you're like, say a Kellyism, and my brain went blank. I was like, I don't know. The list is so long of Kellyisms, but I can say that he is as funny around our house as he is on videos. And, you know, we laugh and have ridiculous conversations with Kellyisms in them all the time. So I'll say that much.
All right, good, good.
And I'll tell you, you know, J-Star is the greatest wing woman I've ever had. Greatest training partner I've ever had in 20 years of putting up with me. I mean, it's so integrated into our house. I mean, even our kids, they get – and we're in on the joke. I mean, I think that's what we want people to understand is we get it. We're talking about, you know, really unsexy, very boring things. And, you know, the least we can do is be human about it.
Right, right. That's what I love about your stuff is that it's very relatable. I'm like, that guy's like somebody I went to college with or something. Like, we're buddies already. You know, it's somebody I can relate to. So, yeah, that's awesome. So that's a good start. Now, I was talking to one of my clients. I refer people to your stuff a lot because I feel like these are things that people need to be working on. They need to put in their mobility homework and putting that time in. And one of them was like, I referred them to your podcast, The Ready State. And they're like, well, what does that mean? You know, like ready for action, ready to go. So how do you guys define – I've heard you ask other people this question on the show. So how do you guys define being in a ready state?
I mean, it sounds oversimplified, but I really think it's like you're ready for anything, meaning that you come to the gym and you don't need to warm up and mobilize for an hour and a half before you can do your workout. Or, you know, you can kind of train doing whatever you do, but jump off the couch and run a half marathon on the weekend without having to follow some super special training program. I don't know. What would you add to that?
Well, I would say what we want people to understand is that how can we systematically manage all of the complex psycho-environmental social components of our lives? I just was traveling. No way I can sleep. So what can I control here? I can control the kinds of foods I'm eating, right? Today, you know, the thing that I'm probably going to get done is going for a walk, you know? And so the idea here is we can be as granular as we want to be around, you know, do we have full access to our positions? Are we metabolically fit? Are we strong enough to play with my kids or go for a hike? But on the other hand, it's for us on our day-to-day level, it's trying to help people wrap their heads around this big task of being a physical human. So the ready state is about saying, hey, how can you improve the ball today? And then that concept of, you know, managing what you can manage, improve what you can improve, leaves us into realizing that this is an infinite game. We'll never have it dialed because we're humans. I mean, God forbid you ever have a kid or a commute. You know, I mean, like your best laid plans are now toast. So what are we talking about?
I think if I could just add to that too, I think what we see sometimes in the fitness industry generally and probably also in the nutrition industry is people are adding more complexity to people's lives. And we see that what people need is that actual complexity to be taken away. You know, sometimes like people don't have time. They've got three kids. They can't spend 4 hours on a Sunday meal prepping for their whole week. Right. That's not always realistic for people. Or, you know, they do have a 2-hour commute. They can't get in, you know, an hour of mobilization and 2 hours of workout in a day. So sometimes I think, you know, the fitness and health advice is being dispensed is actually like, it's great if you're in the business and you have time in your day, that's your profession. So you have time in your day to do those things, but it often doesn't translate to like regular people who are trying to just make, you know, eat a little bit better or add a little bit of movement into their life or just basic, you know, their goals are just, they want to be healthy, be able to play with their kids, you know, avoid disease, just the basic things.
Right. And we want to shift onus and responsibility back onto us. That this isn't something that's happened to us. You know, if you pin us down, the first thing we're going to say is, well, tell us about your sleep. you know? And if you're drinking two bottles of wine to be able to go to sleep at night, we have a problem. If you're dragging that laptop, you want to lose weight or be fitter or not be in pain, and you're dragging your laptop to bed and not getting 7.5 hours of sleep. I mean, there are places where we can make conscious change that doesn't cost us very much, you know? And then what you end up happening is you build a much more resilient system. So the first and foremost, when we say ready state is, well, hey, how can we take responsibility in really small actionable steps? That means it's process, not perfection. And that, I think a lot of people say that better than we do, but there is so much that you can do on a day to day, you know, drink some water, go for a walk, you know, spend 5 minutes rolling around. Boom. That's a physical practice. You killed it today. You took two of your phone calls. You took standing up instead of sitting at your desk. Right. And I think when you start thinking of it in those terms and you then start aggregating those small behaviors over months and years, it makes massive amounts of change. And that's sort of what we're saying. But you can spin that up to say, hey, it's impossible for me to cover every conceivable aspect of my human performance, and whether that's going to my work or being present with my kids. So what I can say is I can control this, and then that's good enough. So that's our notion. Like, hey, how ready can we be?
Right. And I kind of, when I hear you guys talk about ready state a lot, I kind of envision it as living life without a warm up. Like, you need to go climb on a ladder. You don't need to do a big mobility circuit before you climb on the damn ladder. If your dog takes off and you have to go out and get it, you can go and get the dog. You know what I'm saying?
Okay. Yeah. Or like, can you be full human? Right.
Yeah. Like, yeah. Kelly and I always think it's funny because we know all these people who, you know, we like to ski, and, you know, there's a few hours from here, there's a big ski hill. And we always think it's funny because people say, oh, you know, I went skiing for the first time this year and I'm super sore. You know, and we think like, hey, actually, you know, if you're kind of just doing some really basic stuff leading up to a ski season, then, you know, ideally you're not actually sore from your first day of skiing because you've just been doing some, you know, real basics.
You know, and I think the problem right now is that we're getting a lot of information around tracking and hypercomplexity and micronutrients and supplements. And what we really, Juliet and I really feel like is you could probably sleep more. You can probably work harder at work, believe it or not. You can work harder in your physical practice, and you can still have time to chill out. And that you're actually capable, believe it or not, of doing a lot more work than you think of. And instead of kind of getting in the weeds, here's an example. One of our friends is a guy named Nick Gill, who's the strength and conditioning coach for the All Blacks. And, you know, Juliet was just having a chat with him about, you know, kids' nutrition. And she's like, what do kids need to eat? He's like, they don't need to eat. They need to go play. You know, and he's like, well, I guess, I mean, maybe at a halftime you should have an orange slice, you know? And he's like, you know, he's like, what drinks do they need? He's like, oh, water's really great.
Yeah, you know, and just by way of context, you know, I in my own experience, I, you know, when my kids play sports, it's like, you know, if they're in an hour or 2 hour game, I mean, parents bring enough food for an army and are feeding the kids a whole meal at halftime. And then, you know, a gigantic snack that includes donuts afterwards. And, you know, so that was sort of Nick Gill said, yeah, actually like an orange slice and a sip of water would actually be all they need for like an hour and a half game.
Like simplicity, right? Like, do they eat breakfast? Are they gonna eat lunch? You know?
Yeah.
And I think when you look at his programming, and I'm talking about the programming for the All Blacks, like probably one of the greatest teams on the planet, it's elegantly simple. It is so simple. And yet I guarantee you I have very few friends who could complete any of those workouts because they're savage in their simplicity, right? And I think that's what we want to get back to is that we really add a lot of complexity. And as soon as we add complexity into our lives around tracking or food or sleep or – we take our eye off what's important, and what's important is first principle. So what we think is, you know, we can have our young pitchers throw more. You can run more. You can actually be more efficient at work. You can come home and actually have more energy, but you have to take care of first principles. And that's what really we've ended up getting into when we started talking about position and improving positions. And by way of that, we're going to have to talk about tissue health. And when we talk about tissue health, by way of that, we're going to have to talk about sleep. And we're going to talk about hydration and food and your psycho-emotional selves. And really interrelated. And we can't ever address ultimately the expression of your physical self unless we have a conversation with these other things. And that's why the ready state really spoke to us, because it was saying, hey, look, we're imperfect and it is impossible to be a modern human today with all the demands that we have from work and family, et cetera, et cetera. So Stop trying to be perfect. In the meantime, there's a lot of work you're not doing that's really easy. So let's quit dicking around about the stuff that you can't control. Let's control what we can't control.
So what would you guys say are some of the like the key things where Americans in general are just screwing it up? Like, what are some of the big things that we're going the wrong direction on? We need to quit doing these things and it's going to make things better immediately.
I mean, I think Kelly said it originally, you know, we are obsessed with sleep. I mean, we are like the nerds who leave the Memorial Day barbecue at 7 o'clock because yes. our kids need to go to bed at 8 o'clock, right? And, you know, we typically sleep 8 to 9 hours a night and we try, I mean, and obviously, you know, things come up, we travel and whatever, but like when we are able to control our sleep, our goal is 8 to 9 hours a night. It means that we can't watch as much Game of Thrones as we want or you know, spend as much time. But what we've realized is like we're rarely ever doing anything very productive after 9 o'clock at night. And if we are still awake at the time, we're probably watching TV and like eating snacks. So we should just go to bed. That would be the first thing that we are.
When we do that, what ends up happening is that we don't wake up tired. And because we don't wake up tired, we drink less coffee. And then because we didn't have to drink a bunch of coffee and we're tired, we actually didn't have to come down by drinking a glass of wine and chilling out.
Yeah, and then at
we moved, you know what I mean?
Because we're not so under rested at 4 o'clock at the office, we don't need to eat, you know, 27 Hershey's Kisses out of our neighbor's Hershey Kiss bowl because we're so exhausted and we need a little like afternoon pick me up. So, you know, I cannot recommend if people take one thing away from this entire podcast is that they read a book called Why We Sleep by Matt Walker. He's a UC Berkeley sleep researcher. It is not a technical book. It's super readable by the average person, and it will change your mind about prioritizing sleep because there'll be people that listen to this that say, oh, yeah, I don't actually have time to do that. I only sleep 5 hours a night, or, you know, I don't have time to do this, whatever. People will make a lot of excuses why they don't prioritize sleep, but I swear no one can read this book start to finish without taking a serious look at their own sleep practices and really trying to improve them.
That means you're sleeping in a pitch dark room. That's cold. That's quiet.
That doesn't include your iPad or your cell phone
in
it or your TV.
We feel very strongly about no technology in the bedroom. It really, really disrupts your sleep. And then try to be consistent. Go to bed at the same time and just do it for a week and see what happens. I mean, nothing, you're not going to miss anything for a week if you're in bed by 10. I guarantee you're not.
Yeah, nothing good is happening. And then if I could add one other thing, I mean, if we could leave this with two things, sleep. And the other thing is moving around a lot. And I don't mean exercise. So if Kelly and I were asked the question, if you had to give up walking around or actually training hard in your life, like altogether, you had to choose one or the other, we would choose walking.
Interesting.
We think that we have, you know, I saw this really interesting graph came across my eye when I was doing research for our nonprofit Stand Up Kids. You know, gym memberships was going like this on a line. And obesity was going like this on a line, right? So people are joining the gym more and we're still getting fatter, which what that means to me is people are really trying to do the right thing. They've gotten the message like, you must exercise. It's important for your health. It's important to maintain your weight. You got to get to the gym. You got to exercise. But it turns out that that's actually not making the impact that we want on our health and our obesity rates. And I think it's because we were kind of sold a bill of goods, which is go to 24-hour fitness for an hour and be on the Stairmaster and you're good. You can sit there for the other 23 hours of the day. And turns out like it's way better to maximize your what we call non-exercise activity than do a hard training session at the gym. So, I mean, whether that means switching to a standing desk, taking, you know, if you ever have to be on a conference call, you put your earbuds in and start walking, take a walk at lunch, walk around with your kids when you get home from, you know, work. Or, you know, we started this thing in our neighborhood called the walking school bus because we realized that everybody lives within a mile and a half of school and nobody was walking to school.
Wow.
It turns out that we can walk our kid to and from school and still be at our office by 9. So, you know, it's, again, I think a lot of people think, oh, I can't walk my kid to school. And obviously that's not possible for everybody. Certainly plenty of people.
We're back in the house at 8:05.
Yeah, plenty of people live too far from school. So this is not for you. But I mean, if you live within 2 miles of school, you know, that's starting your workday having walked 5,000 or 6,000 steps or like a 5K before you even step into your office. Like that's something you control. That's a win. So, I mean, if I were to leave today and say like two things you could do for your health that are actually pretty easy, which is like walk around and get as much non-exercise activity as you can get in a day and like prioritize your sleep. Would you add anything to that?
Yeah, and what's interesting is when we look at the data around injuries in kids, for example, there's only two things we actually know we can control for. One of them is sleep, and the second one is eating whole foods. And when you have people actually eat whole foods, and whole foods, remember, don't have any ingredients. They're foods.
Right.
And that's an easy way of saying that. Even one of our friends said, hey, in order to meet that whole food definition, try to get 800 grams of fruits and vegetables a day. Don't care if they're fruits. If you want to eat 800 grams, almost a kilo
of oranges,
of apples, go for it. It won't happen. You won't eat, you know, 2 pounds of apples many days in a row, right? You just won't. But what we see is that when we come back to whole food nutrition, we manage our sleep, we start moving around a little bit more, we end up being being orcas. One of our friends uses this analogy in her book, Move Your DNA. Her name's Katie Bowman. And she points out that when you put orcas into captivity, one of the things that happens is after a while, their fin starts to fold over. And it's called folded fin syndrome. And that's a function of two things happening. One is that by putting the orca in captivity, you are fundamentally changing the environment in which the orca exists, and it's spending a lot more time at the surface. So our modern lives have changed the environments in which we thrive, which means we're not squatting on the ground, we don't sit on the ground, we don't toilet on the ground, we don't cook, we don't get up and down. We aren't moving around enough just during the day, just from day to day, right? That 10,000 steps actually exists for a reason. That's our basic minimum movement, right? It's like having an RDA of vitamin C, right? Or vitamin D. You got to get some sunlight on your body. You got to move. What ends up happening then, the second thing is that because the orca doesn't swim, it's not loading the fin all the time. And so because it's not loading the fin becomes weaker, which is what we know is happening to our bodies at a cellular level. When they're not loaded, they actually become weaker. And I don't mean like I can't deadlift as much or squat as much. I mean my tissues literally can't handle loading. And so suddenly what we have is an organism, us, that is not living in an environment that is conducive to being human beings. And then we're not loading the body, and that leads to a lot of really strange things in the body that looks like folded fin syndrome. So we're not able to express our orca selves. And what Juliette is saying is, hey, some movement, some mechanotransduction, some forces at the cellular level are important. Eating whole food nutrition and sleeping, those are the tenets, the beachhead of beginning to then have the next conversation. When we see people begin these things first, it's transformational. We had a person come up to us and like at the end of the year, they're like, this walking school bus changed my life. We're like, how? Your kid's getting better grades? And they're like, no, I lost 20 pounds. We're like,
that's awesome.
You lost 20 pounds walking your kids to school a mile each day? I was like, that is really your body screaming you needed input. Because that was only getting another 5,000 steps. So, and it is that easy. I think our bodies, once we start to get consistent, our bodies start letting go of the, you know, the hold on. And we're working hard to sabotage ourselves. And only because it's so insidious, you know. Tech is there, the commute is there, the way we live our world, the environmental cues that we have. So right now, Juliette and I are sitting on the floor as we're having this talk. And that part of it is, we've got to sit on the floor. It's uncomfortable to sit on the floor. You got to shift around a lot. Your hips are in these end ranges, right? I mean, here's a good example. In cultures that toilet on the ground and sleep on the ground, right? So they sleep on the ground and toilet on the ground. The fall risk in the elderly drops to zero. They don't fall.
Wow.
Right? Hip disease and lumbar disease goes away. Why? Because you got to squat up and down every day.
Right.
Your spine has to be a spine. And suddenly when you take a step back, you suddenly see why the Chinese say, hey, you're only as old as your spine. You know, the Russians say you're only as old as your feet. And I think what's really interesting is that if we just create an environment where I'm naturally doing the right thing without having to make another decision, we call that a constrained environment, I automatically do the right thing, right? So, you know, if – and that's how we want people to begin to conceptualize – you know, the day-to-day challenges, let's make fewer decisions. Let's set up the environment so that I just have to exist in that environment. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
And if I could just add something about the sleep thing when it comes to kids, because presumably a lot of people listening to this will have them.
Yep.
You know, we have two really nice, very well-behaved kids. And sometimes I think, you know, people say, man, you know, your kids, like, they're just so nice and they get along well and they're so well-behaved and
I'm a great
alert.
Dad.
And I literally... I feel like I have had this secret, and it's like this secret thing that, like, Kelly and I actually were the not very good parents, and we don't have very good instincts. But our one, the one instinct that we got right as parents is, like, we have prioritized our kids' sleep. Like, our daughter is in seventh grade. She goes to bed at 8 o'clock at night. Like, this notion that middle schoolers need to go to bed at 10 o'clock at night, like, that's a bunk notion, man. Kids need 10 to 12 hours a night, hours of sleep a night.
Especially if they're in sports.
And I really think people could do a better job of making the connection between their kids' behavior issues and sleep. Like, if I got a call from my teacher that my kid was having behavioral problems, the first thing I would do would be, like, evaluate my kid's sleep. Like, am I letting my kid take technology in the room? Am I putting my kid to bed early enough? You know, am I prioritizing sleep on the weekends? Like, what's the, you know, that would be the first thing I'd do if I had a kid that was exhibiting any kind of issue of any kind, would be like, what's going on with their sleep?
You know, if we you know, on weekends, we want to sleep in a little bit. You know, we don't sleep in much. We still get up pretty early. But if our kids know that it's the weekend and there's nothing going on, they'll get up at like 6, their normal time, and turn on the TV. Right. So we have to be like, no TV until 10. That means that they sleep until 7, you know, at least they get up, you know, at a more reasonable time. So, you know, I think the issue for people is that making real long-term behavioral change is really difficult. And what we try to do, get people to realize is, hey, you can touch anywhere to begin. It doesn't matter. You know, beginning with your mobility conversation, your positions, what position starts with, hey, let's spend some time in the bottom position of the squat. Let's get into the couch stretch. Let's roll something that hurts. And then we can have the next conversation. But if we're really trying to, you know, get the organism back online, it's a lot easier than we think. It's just not sexy. I mean, you can't brag on Facebook or, you know, Insta about, you know, your sleep. No one cares.
Yeah. PR, 10 hours. Thank you, everybody. Yeah.
Killed it.
PR.
Doesn't happen. Now, you guys have brought up your kids a couple of times, and that's a subject that I want to talk about. I have two young kids. I've got a 3-year-old daughter and a 7-year-old giant of a son, and he's 95 pounds and he's 4'6" at 7 years old. He's a freak in a good way. But so how structured and how much, like, program and control goes in? Like, you guys have a lot of personal knowledge in health, fitness, you know, body, how the human body works, but you also have access to some of the brightest minds in health, fitness, medicine. Like, knowledge is power, but how much of that do you pull in with, like, how you parent your kids? Like, do you family mobility sessions? Do you, like, how do you feel about, you know, do you, you know, give them certain warm-ups to do before they do their sport? Or, like, how involved is that with all this knowledge that you've got?
Well, let me give you a crazy example. So we work along the frontiers of sports performance. That's like the bleeding edge. One of the things that we can see is that your genetics, your personal genetics and personal genomics and epigenetics matter, you know, which means that you're not excused from running. It just means that your running may look different than my running, right? In terms of volume, intensity, you know, speeds, those sort of things. So you are naturally going to be a better runner in this, but we're both going to run still. So it's never, we don't use this apologetics, right? What it says, for example, my genetics is that if I tried to eat keto, I would become 500 pounds and my blood panel would be a hot mess. Why? Because I don't process saturated fats or fats very well.
Right.
In fact, as soon as I add all that fat to my coffee, I get diarrhea. In fact, we call that disaster pants. Like, it's a one-way trick it, right? And my genetics indicate that I'm what we call lean paleo. So, you know, what it means is that I should eat with a little bit less fat than some of my friends who can process it very well. I just don't process it. Well, we had our kids' genetics tested because that's who we are. And one of the things we found out, for example, with Georgia is that Georgia has really low desire to move indicators. So her desire to train is really like 18th percentile. My desire to move is like 98th percentile. So Juliet's like, hey, want to do this? I'm like, let's go. I'm always up for it. So Georgia, though, knows that she knows this about herself. And so her tendency is like, hey, I'm just going to read this book and hang out. But we have to give her the kind of the cattle prod sometimes, like, let's go train. And once she's moving, she loves it, right? She's a savage kid who loves to be active. For Caroline, for example, we found out that Caroline's recovery scores were really low, that her session costs are pretty high when it comes to training. And so what that means is that Sorry, we'll mess around. So what that means is that if Caroline doesn't get at least 10 hours of sleep, she is not herself. And so what we know about her recovery scores means that we really protect her sleep even more, and she's cognizant of that. So on the one level, we have this very nuanced version of what's going on underneath the hood. On the other end, we go to bed early. We don't have multiple meals. We make a meal, and that's what our kids eat. And if they don't want to eat, they don't eat. You know, our Caroline has like had many times. It's like, I'm not having dinner. And she's like, we're like, fine. And she wakes up talking about breakfast, you know, and she doesn't have another snack. We don't make her pizza. She doesn't get chicken wings. She gets nuggets, right? She's just not eating dinner. So,
yeah, you know, I mean could I just interrupt? Yeah. I mean, that's like one of our big family rules is like, well, I'm not a short order cook. We make one dinner. And if you don't want to eat it, you're not forced to eat, and you're never forced to eat, but you also aren't then 9 o'clock can't come say, I'm hungry right before I go to bed. And then I give you like an apple or a snack. No, like dinner is your chance and you eat that or you don't eat. And guess what? Like our kid does not starve if she doesn't eat dinner. She then eats like two omelets and a giant bowl of oatmeal for breakfast or something. I mean, she's perfectly fine. So we're pretty strict about that. But I think like, you know, we do, even though we have access to all this like high tech information and people, I mean, I think we really do stick to the very basics. You know, we don't give up on food. You know, our kids go to school with a vegetable and a fruit and a protein in their lunch every day. And I don't care if the vegetable comes home, like it's in there every day. Because I want them to know, like, this is what a balanced meal should look like. Someday they're going to eat it, right? And, you know, the sleep. And then we also have a rule in our family, like, you have to get physical activity every day. You can choose what that is. So whether you want to do a martial art or dance or gymnastics or a sport or whatever, that's 100% your choice. But the act of doing it isn't really a choice.
And I think what Juliet points out is that we create an environment where our kids have agency. But this is what our family does. You know, we're going to go for a walk. We go for hikes, right? And we also just sort of spring loaded in. Like we have a slack line in the backyard that our kids just walk on. It's not like on the way to take the trash out, right? And so, we have an ice tank, and our kids, you know, Georgia will get in the ice tank, and she learned how to breathe through that pain. And when she broke her leg this year on the trampoline, she defaulted right to the same breathing she learned. So. Wow. That's all shorthand for kids model what the environment looks like. And if you are eating crap, your kids are going to eat crap. And if you eat foods, your kids are going to model that over the long haul. And for us, it's about plan. You know, Juliet's going back to the World Championships in Argentina this fall with her master's team. And Juliet and I are always racing. We're competing. We're playing around. And our kids do too. And so we just try to be consistent so that there's never ever a thing that feels heroic or we're extreme. It's just background noise. And given enough time, Georgia will go out and order a Caesar salad because that's what she likes and that's a better choice than the pizza option. So, you know, we'll see that over time it always catches. And so just conceptualizing the world a little bit. And now, I mean, even like Caroline will be like, hey, can you smash out my calves? I'm like, yes, I can.
Yes, I can.
Well, like, you know, I don't know if you follow me on Instagram, but there was a Caroline got home from school ahead of us, you know, like 20 minutes ahead of us a few weeks ago. And she had just gotten out the blender and was making herself a protein smoothie.
Yes. Before practice.
Before practice. And her after school snack. And I walked in the door and I was like, this is going to be like one of Kelly's happiest parenting moments. Like he comes in to find our kid making a protein smoothie
making
after
the right,
school.
Making the right choice.
Yeah.
Right?
He was like so pumped to see that.
You know, and I think the problem with human beings is that it's hard for us to always keep the long game and keep context in our brains. And that because the life today is about these needs and this moment. And a lot of the long-term health problems, a lot of the long-term injury issues are what we call normal accidents. They're normal expressions of a compromised system if you give that system enough time, you know? So I've always eaten like, no problem. And then until one day it is a problem. And it's hard for us then to go and develop really strong relationships between cause and effect because the length of the game is so long. It's decades long. And one of the things that we I think we want people to understand is that you're going to be 100 years old. You're going to be 100. Like, this is where we're going. I mean, if you already, like, if you make it to 40, you already have a 50% chance that you're going to be 94. I mean, things have happened. And if you look at the world and thinking, 100 is not going to be a big reach in our generational time. So the question is, what kind of person do you want to be at 100? Do you want to, you know, how much function do you want to have? What kind of life do you want to have in your 60s and 70s and 80s and 90s and 100s? And unfortunately, those decisions start getting made for us in our 20s and 30s, even in our teens. And it's problematic because the human being is so tolerant, this body, this machine, the amount of stress we can take as a culture, the amount of dysfunctional sleep we can manage and still be extraordinary. The human body, we want people to know, is not a fragile pinche machine. This thing, I mean, I can only feed you little chocolate donuts and cigarettes for next month, and I know you can still beat me in the marathon. Like, you are incredible. But what ends up happening is that tolerance starts, that window gets a little bit thinner and thinner as you make that timeline out. And eventually the system backs up. And it may be in a torn Achilles. It may be plantar fasciitis. It may be, you know, a heart problem. It may be weight. It may be sleep insomnia, right? There are so many issues there. But what we want people to realize is if you take care of the basics first and just let those basics ride, it's not sexy, but it's like, you know, the idea of, you know, was it a, you know, a accumulating interest, or, you know, when you make, you know, you put a little money in the bank and over time it aggregates into real money. And that's how these behaviors are. So today is today, and tomorrow you get to reinvent yourself and go again. So every day is sort of the short game, but the idea is to really play the long game. And that's why the ready state matters, because today it may have been, hey, I'm sleep deprived and all I had was this crappy airport. I got like one weird vegetable that was anemic, right? But at least I ate that and I walked around and I drank some water and I tried to do those things. And it wasn't heroic, because the Instagram has really confused me. Like, I feel bad about myself. I look at Instagram and I'm like, I only have 4 abs. I don't have 27 abs. You know, I'm weak. I don't have hair. You know, everyone doesn't even eat. They drink gluten-free vodka and eat, you know, hamburgers without buns on top. It's everyone Olympic lifts, and it's very confusing. And what we want people to realize is that those are styles, but the real basics are the basics. And what's great about the things that Juliet has been talking about, these basics, is that they make the foundation for elite level performance as much as day-to-day performance. So we have these same conversations with our best athletes and the best teams, and, you know, it's the same conversation over and over again. And so when people do these things for themselves, which seem like such low level, simple, unsexy things, they're really, this is the key to elite level performance, whatever that means in your life.
Can I say one more thing on thing too?
Yeah.
You know, being a parent is really hard, especially when your kids are little.
Yeah.
And I appreciate and love the phrase choose your battles, because I think for a lot of parents, it's like just one battle to the next battle to the next battle with their kids. What I see in my observation a lot is the battles that parents often give up on are food and sleep. And if I could give a piece of advice and say, man, don't give up on those two battles. You know, choose some other battle to give up on besides food and sleep. Like, if, you know, be consistent on those two things. Don't give up on those two. Give up on some other stuff. Like, let your kid watch another half an hour of Minecraft versus, like, you know, letting them eat chicken nuggets every night for dinner, whatever it is. But, like, those would be the two I would advise. Like, don't give up on those two. I see that's one. You know, it's easier when your kid's having a tantrum at Safeway to hand them a bag of Goldfish than understand what's going on with them and their emotions. And I understand you don't want to be that parent in that situation. But, like, those are two things to really just focus on and not give up on.
Yeah, I love the theme of simplicity that you guys run through your lives, whether it's you working with yourselves, your family, the average American, or the elite athlete. It's like the basics work, and just, it's more about being consistent. And something else that I noticed with you guys that I really respect and appreciate is it seems like you have an awareness of balance, like that home life, work life balance. That's something that I'm always trying to be just aware of. And I know that you guys get multiple opportunities every single day put in front of you. So I want to be respectful of your time along those lines. But what would you guys say, like, as far as that relationship of taking on that next thing and more opportunity When do you start to say enough so that the balance is still there?
Let me say this. First of all, is that if you're a modern person, I mean, we have a 25-year-old director of production who has a little more free time than we do, right? His life is pretty fabulous. But if you're an average person, that means you have a job and maybe you're in a committed relationship and maybe you have kids. You're as busy as anyone else is. You're maxed out. And what we really see is that people are flying around. And then in our little bit of breathing room, we're on social media and on the TV and stuff. And a lot of times what Juliet and I realize is we're trying to self-medicate. We're trying to come down because it has been go, go, go. And so what I'll say is that we have a lot of work right now, and that's great. But I wouldn't say that our family is more or less busy than another family. But what we do think of is if you heard us say that we just prioritize and put walls up around the basics. Like, you know, it took us weeks to get through, you know, Wild Wild Country on Netflix. You know, we couldn't.
Great documentary, by the way.
We couldn't get down to it, and around that, you know, I think the central idea is we run everything through this filter. Does this get our family more time together or less together? And at an even more granular level, the number one thing in my world that makes my life work and the most important resource that I have for my own health and happiness and success is my wife. And if I take care of the most important basics, am I spending time with my family? Am I hanging out with my wife? And are her needs met? Then everything gets really clear, because it's easy to lose the narrative because you're running around so much, you know, and you'll see that it comes down to first principles again. You know, families that eat dinner together tend to do really well, and kids have really we should be sitting down eating food. That's what humans do. Like, we sit down and eat food together, and again, we get highlined or sidetracked because it's so easy to grab a burrito on the way, right? And so slow down. For us, I think the magic, and I will just say in full caveat that we something that has been transformational for Juliet and I, for me particularly, is we have this thing called the feelings meeting. So as we work together, we every Wednesday we go out, and that's our staying date night, because Juliet's mom, bless her heart, lives about a mile and a half from us, and she takes the kids right after school. We go out to an early dinner and we sit down and we say, how's it going? It's the one time where we get to really, you save up whatever crap is going on, however I'm messing up. Juliet waits, and then she's like, bam, I need to talk about my feelings. And, you know, the feelings meeting for us is one of those blocked decisions, constrained environments, where every Wednesday we have a formal time where we just sit down and talk about our feelings and seeing how we're doing. And that's that kind of model and thing that makes the thing go. And the last feelings meeting, Juliet was like, what the hell happened in May? Like, we got way out of control. Too much travel. This is bullshit and unsustainable, and let's not do this again. And I was like, holy shit, right. This was the worst month ever. So again, you'll never have it dialed. Stop thinking in those terms. Start thinking in, hey, I bet I can improve next month.
And if I could add to one thing that I found very freeing to me was when I realized that there actually is no such thing as balance. And I stopped trying to attain that as a goal. And, you know, I don't mean to like kill your balanced dreams, but I literally used to think of it like, do I have work-life balance? Am I achieving my work-life balance? Like, do I have any balance? And I actually felt like it all of a sudden, you know, the thought of attaining balance, whatever that means, was an extra stressor in my life. And so, you know, I realized that, you know, the way I think of it a little bit is like, you know, like Kelly and I are in our 40s. Like, your 40s are like your peak earning time as a human. Right? Like, if you do well earning in your 40s, you might actually be able to retire. Right? So I think about my 40s as like, you know, this is a time where like, I may not have as much balance as I'd like. Like, I need to deep work. I need to cook. I need to raise my kids, get them ready to be adults. And then like, I'm going to look forward to having a little more balance later. You know, so I think in those terms of like, it's actually okay that we're in a phase of our lives where we're like deeply busy, and that's okay.
And I would say, what we do try to delineate is the difference between being busy and having a lot of work. Because we see plenty of people who look busy, but they're not busy. They're just messing around, right? And I know plenty of people who you would describe themselves as busy who are working their asses off. But first and foremost, for us, you know, are we spending more time together as a family having dinner? You know, is the number one taken care of? And, you know, am I able to express my feelings as a man on Wednesdays? Yes, I'm getting better at that. So when we do that, then all of a sudden, you know, the work doesn't – it seems really sustainable. You know, when our next sessions of the Ready State podcast, we're talking about pain and persistent pain and chronic pain and some of the really interesting aspects of that. And there tend to be in psychology, you'll see that people end up freaking out and doing weird things for kind of three belief reasons. One is that it's you say, I can't stand this, whatever it is, right? I can't stand my relationship. I can't stand my job. I can't stand, you know. Two is that you think, hey, it's going to get worse. And three, you think it's never going to end. And, you know, I think in the short term, we set those things up for us to be failures, and then we will self-sabotage, you know. And some of it's because it's, you know, I swing in. I was just traveling it very early somewhere at a conference last week and or 2 weeks ago, and I saw it's like 5:20 in the morning, and a guy gets in the line at Pinkberry to get a gigantic frozen yogurt. He's an adult. And the woman's like, we don't open till 6, sir. And she was disgusted that this guy was, and I was like, bro, you don't get ice cream because you're an adult at 6 in the morning. Like, there's some points where you have to take ownership. And that's just like, I literally was like, I would have slapped it out of his hand. Like, eat this bagel instead, sir. Like anything else besides, you know, an ice cream sundae in the morning. But, you know, some of those things are, you know, let's be a little bit more reasonable and then consistent. And unfortunately, you know, that's the recipe for long-term success and grit.
I love it. I love just you guys' vibe as a couple. I love that you are business partners, life partners, and you run the show together. So that's awesome. Now, I want to make sure that my audience can connect with you guys. Obviously, we've given them a taste of the Starrett power. where do they go to connect with you? I know we got the Ready State podcast, a mobility wad. Subscribe. Just do it. It's amazing. So what's the best way to make sure they can connect with you, follow your story?
I mean, you've got it. MobilityWad.com. You can find the Ready State podcast there on MobilityWad. Kelly is at MobilityWad on Instagram and Twitter.
Yeah, and you're Mrs. Yeah. MobilityWad.
Yeah, I'm at Juliet Starrett on Instagram, and that's where we are.
And, you know, there's plenty of – you can start coming to this conversation anywhere. We definitely have some books out there that makes it easier to understand. We have courses. One of the ways that we think that we're trying to help the make less noise is that we started a daily – we've been making daily videos for almost 10 years. We've been doing this for a long time around trying to improve your positions and make you feel better. But one of the things that we really made a big effort over a year ago is we started doing daily follow-along videos. So every day we make a brand new video that's fresh where you can have a roller and a ball and put it on your TV, and in the last 10 minutes of the day – follow along. We'll tell you what you need. And if you just have a cheap ass roller, dude, you can use a wine bottle. If you have a kid's, you know, lacrosse ball, you have a baseball, you can play along. You don't need special equipment. But have this conversation with us because you're going to learn a lot. There it is.
There
you're
going to learn a lot.
And I think that's really what we want. We want people, you know, what we think, what we've done is created a situation where we all think we have to be experts at everything. And what we want people to understand, it's okay to be a beginner. And after you've been a beginner a while, you'll automatically take the next step. So don't worry about it. Put the ball in some place that hurts and roll around on it for 5 minutes, and then roll around the other side in the exact same spot for 5 minutes. Compare those sides, and then guess what? Tomorrow you can have the next conversation. And I think that's what gets lost in this context is I have enough time to develop these capacities.
Well, I think that's a great way to finish up the deal here. You guys like I said, I appreciate you saying yes. I know you have lots of opportunities, lots of people wanting you to come on their shows and things like that. So the fact that you guys said yes to me, that means a lot. And I want you guys to know that you're people that I look up to. You're people that I try to model my career, my business after. You know, I'm a gym owner. I'm venturing into online space, podcasting. And you guys do it the right way, in my opinion. You always deliver value. You do it in an entertaining way. And you deliver something that actually works for people. So
well,
I appreciate you very, very much.
And thank you for the work you're doing. Like, it is so awesome. I like 100% support your mission wholeheartedly. It's so good.
Yeah, and we want to say especially, you know, no one chooses to feel poorly, or no one self-chooses to be overweight. No one does. You know, I was a chubby kid you know, and with a bowl cut and a girl's name, like the trifecta of problems as a kid, you know, and my name rhymes with smelly jelly belly, which is even worse. So what I'll say is it's going to take a lot of us having a lot of conversations and a lot of different ways to get to the middle. And your community is already extraordinary because they're realizing that, hey, you know, it's actually the power to improve our own lives and have richer family experiences is easy and it's in our own control. It's not elsewhere. But we have been programmed the wrong way and we've made certain assumptions about what our bodies can and can't do. And, you know, it's really fun when we all meet in the middle and we'll all get there.
Yeah. And we're all on the same team. Yeah, we're marching forward. And I can't wait to send you guys an email in the future that says, hey, we just hit 1,000,000 pounds and I want to thank you for being a part of that. So we're going to get there.
Thank you. The real question, thanks so much for having us.
1,000,000 is just, you know, we're just getting started. You know,
yes.
I'm like, why did you start to set such a small goal?
All right. Kelly has laid down the gauntlet for me, everybody. Now the pressure is on. So everybody that's listening in, as always, I want to challenge you to not only just be entertained by the conversation, but how are we going to take action next 24 hours? Are you going to get a lacrosse ball and start rolling around it? Are you going to get up and move tomorrow? What's that action step going to be? Because that, my friends, is how we get out there. That's how we own it every meal, every workout, every day. And I will see you on the next episode. Hold on just one second there. Good looking. I promise you, before the show started, that I had some more info about the 1,000,000 pound mission bootcamp, and I am here to deliver that to you. You don't want to miss out. Basically, here's what happened. I have two amazing programs I've been running for quite a while now locally with my local clients. The Meltdown Bootcamp, it's my just classic bootcamp format, and then a newer product that I call Push 56. And I thought, you know what? I think it'd be really cool to be able to deliver this to anybody, anywhere. So I combined the two products. I reformulated them to put them in an online format, and I'm bringing it to you guys starting in July. It looks like we're going to try to do 1 8-week boot camp per quarter. So the July boot camp will be our kickoff. You can get all the dates, all the info. You can get on the wait list to get first dibs on the roster spots because I only have a certain amount of coaches, so we cannot take an unlimited amount of people. So go to millionpoundmission.com. millionpoundmission.com and get all of the details. You're going to love it. It includes workouts, online workouts, also workouts and prescriptions you can do at your gym, at home, body weight, strength training, whatever. It's all in there. Then it also combines a meal plan. You're going to get to select from our clean eating plan, our paleo plan, our keto plan, our intermittent fasting plan, whatever fits your goals, whatever seems like the best fit for you. That's the program we're going to deliver there. And we have accountability built in. You're going to have an option where you can upgrade and get an accountability coach that touches base with you every single day. We've also got group accountability with a private Facebook group and the Push 56 format. You're going to love. I'm going to have a weekly assignment for you to dig in with that brain food, with that strategic thinking. So we quit messing up with those same danger zones that always trip us up. This is going to be a powerful program. Like I said, roster spots will be limited. Go to millionpoundmission.com. Get on the wait list. It doesn't cost anything to get on the wait list. There's no commitment, but you will get first dibs. You'll have a week prior notice when registration opens up for the 1,000,000 Pound Mission Bootcamp. Check it out.